blended learning, blended learning, blended learning. We're all confused about what this means. Is it a blender that we put our courses into and all the contents and just shake them all up inside? Spin it around a few times? Is it as simple as that? Is it as complex as that? Blended learning. Many definitions, many debates, many misconceptions. This program will walk you through models, advantages, disadvantages, and advice related to blended learning. Other programs will get into implementation issues and the future and where this is all going. So let's take a look at what we have here today. Blended learning general program on defining blended learning. Is it using the word mixed or hybrid? Is that the same thing? Well, Webster's Dictionary defines hybrid as the interbreeding of two or more species of animals to create a mongrel. We'll stay with blended here today, okay? Now, historically, distance learning was separate from face-to-face. Today, they overlap. And this overlapping notion is bringing us to the term blended learning. So historically, this word really didn't come about until the web enabled us, in effect, to combine face-to-face and online learning together. Now that we can do that, now that that's possible, we have this word blended or blended learning, okay? Some people say that less than 30% of a course on the internet is web supplemented or web facilitated, and that more than 80% is considered fully online. I'll just make this blanket statement that if you put any piece of a course, even just 1%, I'd call that a blended course in some way, shape, or form. But the Sloan Foundation has given us guidelines, as well as other foundations and government agencies related to blended learning. My colleague Charles Graham says, you know, in the past, traditional instruction gave us that high humanness, that sense of someone else being there, real-time interaction. But computer-mediated let us reflect on things. And combining the two together brings power because you can reflect, think, debate, and share asynchronously, as well as do things with an instructor and other students synchronously. So now we overlap a bit, we call it blended. In the future, it's going to overlap so much, we'll just call it learning again. Now there are models of blended. There's a bookend model. So the bookend model, basically we've got an online experience to start, an online experience in effect to end your course. So you've got bookends out there, and in between, you might have a face-to-face portion. You have an anchor approach where you start with what people are familiar with. You anchor it in a face-to-face experience. Then you move over to the web after people feel comfortable with it. Okay? So there are different models or different ways to think about blended learning. A field approach just basically combines the best of different things together and mixes and matches, kind of like with your little blender model again, okay? You can blend at the activity level, meaning that if you don't finish a class activity in time, you might push it over to the web to finish a debate that you didn't quite get done during a face-to-face class. You might blend at the course level by deciding to involve students from remote regions to your class or have instructors come from different places around the world. There might also be blended learning at a programmatic or institutional level, where within an online MBA program or a master's in public health, you might have a residency component. And so those are decisions made by administrators as opposed to by the instructor. You can also blend by alternating face-to-face and online classes or by supplementing, which is what most of you are going to do, is supplement your class. You might have, like with the bookend model here, online experiences to start and end. You might have students located in remote regions, like in this model of a course-level blend, where the instructor decided to add students beyond his classroom setting at Brigham Young into other places from Arizona and Idaho and other places. The University of Phoenix uses an institutional model of blended learning where the students might be local, close by, and the first and last weeks of the class, they come to a face-to-face setting. Whereas in their distance model, they only come a half a week to start and a half a week to end, and they have 4 weeks online. That's an institutional administrative decision. Now, some people divide up blended as enhancing blends, enabling blends, and transformative blends. Basically, fully online universities, or those that only exist due to the internet, are enabled to blend with web technologies. Enhancing blends are what you and I probably do the most, and that's create additions, refinements, modifications, and enhancements to our classes by adding online resources and activities. Transformative blends are when you take the class and totally change it due to the web. Now, there are advantages of blended learning with flexibility, reflection time, new resources, time to think, convenience. There are disadvantages as well, right? So these are the categories I mentioned of blended: enabling, enhancing, and transformative types of blend. Disadvantages include procrastination, students just waiting to the last minute or instructor doing so, novelty, but the big one is really trying to add too much to the class and overwhelming everybody with what you've done. Now, there are many aspects to blended that are important to think about in terms of what does the research say? The research says blended is best. Blended is better than face-to-face and online. It's very persuasive in terms of looking at the research that's out there. It's also pervasive. Everyone seems to be doing blended. In the future, maybe most courses will be, in fact, blended. In Canada, my friend Ryan Osten found students love blended learning. At the University of Central Florida, they find dropout rates in blended and fully online are about the same as face-to-face learning. At IBM, they've been able to offload three-fourths of their leadership training to the internet and only do the last quarter face-to-face. At Capella University in Minneapolis, they use online to the maximum degree possible and only meet face-to-face if they have to. So as I mentioned, the IBM model has a four-tiered model. The first three parts rely on computer-based interaction or humans on the internet giving feedback, and they only meet at the end of their training experience. That's how they blend. At National University, their teacher training program has gone to a blended approach where they meet during field experiences, and all their courses in some programs are on the internet. At the University of Malaysia, they let students decide on the course contents. Do they want the CDs? Do they want a face-to-face instruction? Do they want to take the tests? They mix and match components, the online resources and the face-to-face experiences, how they need them. They're adults and they decide. At the University of Glamorgan in Wales and University of Waikato in New Zealand, they have a continuum model from putting pieces of a course on the internet to putting the full course on the internet. So some final advice here about blended learning. Share what you see happening with others. If you're an administrator, evaluate what's going on. Set benchmarks. Make decisions due to your evaluation, not just random or haphazardly. Look at what other institutions are doing. Maybe even read about what other places are doing, and then survey your students. Survey your instructors. Talk to other people who might be teaching a similar course to what you might be designing, and see what their experiences have been in terms of blended learning. And then reflect on things. Create a strategic plan of some kind. Think about when you're blending, when you're adding online components, the percent of time you might add, the degree to which you might add online experiences or activities or components, the type of activities, and then plan for them. Once you implement, then have a focus group about what works, survey your students, survey people using blended, and keep documenting what's going on. Document, share. If you've done innovative things, share them at conferences, share them with other people. People want to find out what's been happening. Write them down. Communicate what's going on. If you've created something unique, create some way to distribute what's been going on within your setting so that others can also take advantage, because this is a crazy area of blended learning, no doubt. We can mix and match things up in our blenders, right? Of course we can. But we can also make logical sense of what's possible out there, right? And you should be trying to do so in your classes. When you have figured that out, start sharing with other people. When you've created a model, document and write it up. Read other people's models. Good luck to all of you with blended learning in your futures. I hope you enjoy, because this is what's going to make your teaching at the high end of satisfaction for you and your students. Good luck.